Well, good morning, everybody. And welcome to Crossroads Baptist Church. We're glad that you're here. For those of you who are here for the first time or the first time in a long time, we're especially glad that you're with us today and hope that you feel at home today and hope that you take a card out of the seat ahead of you, maybe a little to the left or the right. It says connection card across the top. If you would take one of those out and fill that out and take it to the counter in the back corner over there at the end of the service, we have some stuff for you. We've got a coffee mug you can take home as a remembrance of your visit. In that coffee mug is some information about our church and upcoming events and activities. Tells you a little bit more about who we are. And then there's also some goodies in there as well. So that will help make it more enjoyable as well. So we want you to take that home with you. If you do that for us, we'd really appreciate that. And we are very happy to see some of you who haven't been here a long time because of the virus and also because of other reasons as well. One in particular, very special guests of ours today, not really visitors, they're home folk, really, but the Junkert family is back here. Pastor Vic is here for a couple of reasons. One I'll mention in just a moment. The other one is for his daughter's birthday. Joy and her husband are here. Good to see you. Happy birthday, Joy. And Caitlin, good to see you. It's great to have them with us today. They've all been in this church. This is just as much their church as anybody else's. They've been here a long time. In fact, with Pastor Vic and I here both together on the same day, you have half of the pastors who have ever pastored this church together today. All the surviving pastors. Can we say it that way? All right. So Pastor Vic, for those of you who don't know him, is the man who was responsible, let me put it that way, or credited, however you want to put it, with leading me to the Lord. On that Wednesday night in July 1972, he took the initiative of getting off a church bus on Wednesday night of all nights with a suit and tie of all things, with a Bible under his arm on visitation. Who does that? Our church never did. So he talked to me about the gospel that night. I argued with him, as you know, as my custom is. Did not get saved on the street corner there, but he gave me a tract, made me promise to take it home and read it. I did. I kept that promise, got saved that night. He didn't know about it for a couple of years until I looked him up, saw his picture in a national publication called the Baptist Bible Tribune, and wrote to him and told him what I did, and then looked him up at 356 Baroness Way in Gahanna, Ohio, where they lived back then, and we ended up working together on staff here for several years. Then Pastor Vic went off to Toledo for, I don't remember, 9 years or something like that, I don't know how many years it was, and he came back here to be the pastor. And I was his associate for 11 years, and then he moved down south, and then I became the pastor. And so we've had a long history together, 48 years. Can you believe that? 48 years. Is that right? Is my math right? 1972? Yeah, it's been a long time. So anyway, we're very, very happy to have Pastor Vic here today, not only to be in town for his daughter's birthday, but also to assist us with the mortgage burning today. It's a notable day in the history of our church. Amen? So great. So you'll be hearing from him in just a few minutes. He'll be singing some songs for you. But before we go on to the offering, we want to take care of our Bible quiz question of the week. Every week, of course, there is a question in the connector. That's designed to get you into your Bible, maybe help you learn something new, have some fun, and have some rewards along the way. We have a gift card to McDonald's today to give away. The question is, who baptized Paul? Who baptized Paul? That's the Apostle Paul. Who baptized him? The answer is Ananias. Acts chapter 9, verses 17 and 18. He was the one who baptized Paul in Damascus. And we had 15 correct answers to that question. The box is pretty full. So, Brother David, I'm going to ask if you'd draw the winner again. Thank you. And the winner is Danny Hicks. Danny, congratulations. All right. You deserve a break today. Okay. So if you'd like to get... If you'd like to get in on the drawing for next week, just look at the question in the bulletin, and then write down the correct answer and remember to put your name on it. Everybody remembered that today, which is great. So we had a lot of answers in the box, and we'll put your name in the box, and hopefully you can draw the gift card for next week. All right, ushers, if you'd take your places, and let's prepare to give back to the Lord a portion of that which he's given to us in recognition of who he is, where it all came from, trusting God to meet our needs with what's left over after we give to him first and sacrificially. And we're seeing the fruits of that kind of giving today. Talk more about that in just a minute. And we want to keep up our giving, even though the mortgage is paid off, right? Because we want to have that money freed up for ministry. We can do increased ministry with that excess money. Hopefully it's excess if we continue tithing, right? So let's ask God to bless and multiply the offering for his purposes. Brother David, if you would lead us in a prayer, please. Amen, and God bless you as you give.
Before you spoke it to be, you were the King of Kings. Yeah, you were, yeah, you were. And now you're reigning still, enthroned above all things. Angels and saints cry out, we join them as we sing. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God.
Fellas in the same ship, and it's good to be able to do that, to get in the same ship and to be inspired and to have the fellowship and the worship that we can only have in a setting like this. And so I'm glad you're here today, and I'm so grateful for the events that I get to participate in today. I'm so thrilled with what God is doing with Crossroad Baptist Church, and I'm thrilled about how God has his anointing on Brother Paul Gabriel, and preaching the Word of God and being faithful to the Word of God, regardless of the circumstances. You know, I believe in God's grace that is sufficient for our lives. Grace is that electrifying dynamic force of God within us that gives us power and ability to live in harmony with God's Word, regardless of the circumstances. And we can experience that grace every day of our life. Aren't you glad for that? Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise. For it was grace that bought my liberty. I do not know just why he came to save me. He looked beyond my faults, and he saw my need. I shall forever lift mine eyes to Calvary, to view the cross where my Jesus died for me. I'm a falling short. all my need. I shall forever lift mine eyes to Calvary to view the cross where my Jesus died for me. How marvelous the grace that caught my falling soul. He looked beyond my faults and he saw my need. He looked beyond all our faults and he'll see our need. With amazing grace. She glad for his grace? I've rather had Jesus than silver, gold. I'd rather have Jesus than riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. And I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain. This old world affords today. In this world affords today. Much rather have him. Amen. And rather be able to sing this song together. Perhaps you know it. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross. 'Twas the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was laid. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will exchange that is, amen. I'm so grateful for the day that I found out that I could exchange my sin for a crown. I'm thankful for the day that I discovered that I've been bought with a price. I'm not my own anymore, and that I belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, and I can come to him and come to the place where I repent of my sins and turn away from them and turn to God and allow God to be my life, to do what I can't, to change what I can't throughout eternity. How wonderful that is. And to just renounce all of that sin and that sickness that destroys our life, and then come to the place where I finally just surrender it to God and not struggle with it anymore, but let God be my life to do what I can't do. My position is not inferiority and insecurity and inadequacy and worry and doubts and fear and guilt and frustration and hostility and anxiety and depression and looking for a way to escape. But my position is the mind of Christ, the mind and attitude of Christ, the strength and capability of Christ, all of my needs supplied according to His riches and glory and peace that passes all understanding and fullness of joy. I don't have to go around being fearful, false evidence appearing real, but I can put my faith in the Lord Jesus Christ because faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. How wonderful that is to just surrender to Him and know that one day I have the opportunity of looking forward to being with my loved ones in heaven. Are you looking forward to that? I look forward to being with my loved ones in this auditorium, although I didn't recognize some of them. I don't know why everybody looks older and I don't. What's the deal with that? Song says it this way. I'm looking forward to see the streets in glory. All the streets that are paved in purest gold. And I'm looking forward to see the wondrous mansions as they glisten in the golden sun of heaven. Oh, but most of all, my friends, when this life comes to an end, I'm looking forward to see Jesus. This part I like. I'm looking forward to see the saints in glory. All my loved ones that's traveled on before. I'm looking forward just to see their happy faces. And there'll be no mask there, amen. I want to be like Paul on the road to Damascus. Amen, you'll get that. As they're glowing before the throne of God. Oh, but most of all, my friends, when this life comes to an end, I'm looking forward to see Jesus. And oh, so my friends, when this life comes to an end, I'm looking forward to seeing each and every one of you. We'll be able to do that together, Brother Paul, when we kick up gold dust together in heaven. Paul was asking that question about who baptized Paul. I thought I did, but I didn't. Somebody else did. Somebody pointed to me and they said, you did, didn't you, Pastor? And I said, no. I think for whatever time we have left in this world, and God only knows what that timing is, and we're all looking forward to going to heaven. But for whatever time we have left, hey, Brother Conley, good to see you. I'm beginning to recognize people now. For whatever time we have left, we need to be about the Master's business. We need to be fulfilling the Great Commission. Christ said, all power is given unto Him in heaven and earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even into the end of the world. We need to be about the Master's business. And every opportunity, every available means that we have to reach people for the cause of Christ. And when, as a younger Christian, I used to just travel all over the world singing this song, and I'm going to ask Joy to come and Caitlin to come, and they're going to join me in this song. It talks about not being afraid to tell others about the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? We're to be bold about that. When I was just a little boy, no higher than Paul's knee, my mother bought a brick box of crayons just for me. I picked them up, I opened them up, and I looked way down inside, and the colors there reminded me of Jesus when he died. Red is the color of the blood that he shed. Brown's for the crown of thorns they laid upon his head. Blue is for royalty within him did dwell. And yellow is for the Christian who's afraid to tell. I colored and I colored till the crayons were all gone. But though I've grown much older now, the memory lingers on. So when I see a little boy with crayon box in hand, I just tell him what they mean to me, so hope you'll understand. Red is the color of the blood that he shed. Brown's for the crown of thorns they laid upon his head. Blue is for royalty within him did dwell. And yellow is for the Christian who's afraid to tell. Afraid to tell of a Savior who died on Calvary, who died for lowly sinners just like you and me. And someday he is coming back just to be our king. And the colors in the crayon box we'll all sing. Sing it with us. Red is the color of the blood that he shed. Brown's for the crown of thorns they laid upon his head. Blue is for royalty within him did dwell. Yellow is for the Christian who's afraid to tell. And yellow is for the Christian who's afraid to tell. So don't you be a Christian who's afraid to tell.
That was great. That was great. Thank you, Pastor Vic. Joy and Caitlin, thank you very much. Amen.
Thank you.
Appreciate you. God bless you.
I love you.
Thank you, too. All right. Boy, it brings back good memories. Amen? You know, Columbus Baptist Temple was founded in October 1951 by Dr. J. Richard Hankins. His plaque is in the lobby out there. And they started in the old Arlington Theater building out on West Fifth Avenue. The building is still there, but it's no longer a theater. 6 months later, they moved out of Upper Arlington. That's on the border between Upper Arlington and Grandview Heights. They moved up to Indianola Avenue, where they rented a building up there, and then bought property just a couple of years later at Agler Road and Cleveland Avenue, and began preparing to build. We started with a $25,000 loan from Akron Baptist Temple to start this ministry. That was paid back in a year, and then the money was used to help other churches get started as well. But we ended up buying property and building a building and, of course, getting a mortgage to do that, and we have been in debt ever since. And so this is a notable day, the day when we burn our mortgage. When we are now out of debt. Amen. It's a great day. And it's due to the faithfulness and sacrificial giving of thousands of members of Columbus Baptist Temple and Crossroads Baptist Church over the last 69 years. Last week was our 69th anniversary. How many of you have been a member of Crossroads Baptist Church for 5 years? Just put your hand up, okay? How many have been members of this church for 10 years? 10 years. Well, more hands went up. That's odd. How about 15 years? 20 years? 25 years? 30 years? 35 years? 40 years? 45 years? Some don't want to admit they've been there that long. How about 50 years? I got to put my hand down on that one. 55 years. 60 years. 65 years. Should I keep going? 65 years. I'm going to stop there, okay? 65 years. I want to thank you for your faithfulness. I want to thank you for your sacrificial giving. It's because of you that this day has come. It's because of you that this ministry has continued for so long and has affected so many people. Pastor Vic, I think you and I were at lunch the other day. Pastor Vic, you and I were at lunch the other day, and I think you mentioned what Dr. Jim Custer said some time ago. Could you repeat that quote?
It would light up the entire city of Columbus and beyond.
Yeah.
A phenomenal statement. Yeah.
Thank you. And I believe that's true. This church has a long heritage of spreading the gospel throughout the city. We're actually the first mega church in Columbus. God has really blessed and used this church over the years, and you are the ones who made that ministry happen and kept it going. And I want to thank you for your faithfulness. Also, because this day came a little sooner than anticipated, if we had kept on going the way we had been, we would have paid this off another 7 years. But we're doing it today because of the sacrificial gift of Northeast Baptist Church. And I would like to ask the folks from Northeast Baptist Church if you'd stand, please. Just go ahead and stand. Yeah. Thank you. And just remain standing for just a moment. There's a few others who are from Northeast as well, or not standing, but I want to thank all of you for your sacrificial gift that made this day possible. And we have a plaque we'd like to hang in the lobby in honor of what you guys have done. And here's what it says. It has a photograph of the church here at the top. And then it says, in grateful appreciation to the congregation of Northeast Baptist Church for the sacrificial gift of their building and property to Crossroads Baptist Church. Then it has a scripture quotation. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except the corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. And what they have done in giving their church and property to us has shaved 7 years off the mortgage, along with all the interest that would have been paid as well, and has freed up that money each month so that we can do additional ministry and greater ministry from now on. And I, on behalf of Crossroads Baptist Church, I want to thank all of you for your vision and your sacrificial gift. Thank you so much. So this will permanently hang in the lobby, right next to the front door, across from where Dr. Hankins' picture is. So you're welcome to come up and look at that at the end of the service. I'm going to ask our trustees and deacons to come up at this time, if you would. cross there. This is the promissory note. It's part of the mortgage that we got from Middlefield Bank, three and a half years ago, I think it was. We've been with a number of banks over the years. Middlefield was the current mortgage holder. They took good care of us. All of our banks have. But we are also glad to be no longer obligated to them, of course. But this is the promissory note. I'm going to ask Brother Don if you would just kind of hold it up there over the thing. And guys, gather around here. And a couple of you, take this, take that. And we're going to very carefully burn this and hope that hopefully Don won't get his fingers burned. But we're going to eliminate this once and for all. Those of you who have cameras or phones, come up if you need to, get a good picture, and send it to me in a text if you would, if you get a good picture. But let's go ahead and take care of this. Go ahead. I think you have to pull the trigger here. Or push that and then click. Oh, it makes a beautiful light, doesn't it? Amen. Yeah, that's right. That's true. Amen. Well, and all the time, God is good. Amen. Amen. God bless you guys. Amen. It's kind of like the Olympic torch there, doesn't it, almost? But because this has been a marathon, not a sprint. But it's nice to finally have the mortgage gone, something we have anticipated for decades, generations, in fact. What I'd like us to do is talk a little bit more about this concept of a mortgage and what it means and the fact that it's gone. I'm going to ask you to take your Bibles and go back to Leviticus chapter 25, if you would. Leviticus chapter 25, let's spend a few minutes talking about this. Leviticus chapter 25, beginning in verse 10. When you get there, I'm going to ask you to stand as we read a brief portion of Scripture together. Leviticus chapter 25, beginning in verse 10. All right. Leviticus chapter 25. You there? Okay, it says this. And ye shall hallow the 50th year and proclaim liberty throughout all the land unto the inhabitants thereof. It shall be a jubilee unto you, and ye shall return every man unto his possession, and ye shall return every man unto his family. A jubilee shall that 50th year be unto you. Ye shall not sow, neither reap that which groweth of itself in it, nor gather the grapes in it of thy vine undressed. For it is the jubilee. It shall be holy unto you. Ye shall eat the increase thereof out of the field. In the year of this jubilee, ye shall return every man unto his possession. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you so much. Thank you so much for this day and what it means in the life of this church. Father, thank you so much for your faithfulness to us over the years and using each of us to share the gospel with those around us, to have an impact on our community, to be salt and light to the city of Columbus. Father, thank you so much for the way you blessed us, the way you blessed the city through us. Thank you, Father, so much for the faithfulness of all those in these two churches who have made this happen. Father, I thank you. Thank you for all your blessings and your faithfulness, your richness, your mercy. Father, I pray that your Spirit would teach us in these next few minutes what this means to each of us personally, not just as a church, but to us personally. May your will be done in our hearts and our lives today. May we renew our commitments to you this morning, for we ask it all in Jesus' name, for his sake, with thanksgiving. Amen. Go ahead and please be seated. This passage of Scripture we just read is talking about the year of Jubilee. What it was that every 50th year, on Yom Kippur, the holiest day of the Jewish calendar, the Day of Atonement, the 10th day of the 7th month, every 50 years, that was the year of Jubilee. What that means, it was a year of freedom. In fact, the first verse that we read is actually inscribed on the Liberty Bell. Some of you, I'm sure, already knew that. Proclaim liberty unto all the inhabitants thereof. What it's talking about, what the principle is, that God told the Israelites, essentially, this is the land that I'm giving to you. Remember the promise that God made to Abraham way back in Genesis chapter 15. I'm giving you this land. I'm giving you all the possessions of it. I'm asking you to drive out the inhabitants. They're just holding the land for you. I want you to drive them out one step at a time. The houses that they built are going to be your houses. The fields that they have planted are going to be your fields. The orchards that they have grown are going to be your orchards. All of that has been at their effort, their expense, but it's yours. I'm giving it to you. And I want to keep it nice. I want to keep everything just the way it is. It's a good land. I want it to stay a good land. And so because of that, I want you to do things this way. You can sell the land, but you can only sell it up to a period of 50 years, 49 years, essentially. In the 50th year, it comes back to you. In other words, when you sell the land, you can't sell it permanently. You can sell it to somebody with a 50 or 49-year mortgage. If it's only 30 years to the year of Jubilee, you can sell it with a 30-year mortgage. If it's only 5 years to the year of Jubilee, you can sell it for a 5-year mortgage. So you price it accordingly. In the 50th year, it comes back to you. The mortgage is paid. It's free and clear. It's yours again. If you are a slave, nobody can enslave you more than 49 years. In the 50th year, you're going to be free. This is what the year of Jubilee means. God says all debts are canceled. Now, there's another parable in Matthew chapter 18. I won't go through the whole thing, but you are familiar with the parable of the man who had a huge outstanding debt. It probably was a mortgage as well. And he owed his creditor more than he could possibly pay in his entire lifetime. So he went to this creditor and he said, listen, I know I owe you a lot. I know I'm behind on my mortgage. If you'd forgive me, I'll pay you everything I can. And his creditor says, he knew, there's no way this guy can pay it back. Even if he lived to be 100, paid me every nickel he made, never kept anything for himself, he still couldn't pay me back. There's no way he could pay it back. So he said, listen, I forgive you the debt. Your mortgage is clear. You can burn your mortgage. The debt is paid. The man was so grateful, so grateful. He was on his way home to tell his wife, hey, we don't owe any money anymore. He canceled our debt. He cleared up the mortgage. We're debt free. And on his way home, he ran across a guy who owed him like 2 weeks' pay. He said, pay me what you owe me. He was so excited at what just happened. He wanted some money to maybe go out and have a party with his wife or take her to dinner. So he said, pay me what you owe me. The guy said, oh, please. Forgive me, and I'll pay you everything, but I can't do it right now. I don't have the money on me right now. In other words, this guy, who owed him 2 weeks' pay, did exactly what he just did, who owed him a lifetime of pay. Only this guy would not forgive the other guy. He took him by the neck and throttled him, said, pay me what you owe me, and cast him into debtor's prison. Well, the other guy said, hey, he found out about that and says, hey, wait a minute, I forgave you the debt. I forgave you all this stuff. Couldn't you forgive him 2 weeks' debt? And he made him pay up. He took it back and made him pay up. What this is talking about is debt. The Lord is talking about debt, and he's probably talking about mortgages, like we just got rid of. Mortgages are kind of a really heavy weight hanging over everyone of you who bought a house, bought property of some kind. You've gotten a mortgage. If you bought a car and borrowed money for it, that's a form of a mortgage as well. You borrowed money, and you have to pay it back with interest, right? A professor, an economics professor, was trying to teach his students about mortgages and about how they worked and how to figure up the cost, the payments and the total cost and everything. And he wanted to illustrate to his students just how much a mortgage cost. So he taught them, you know, take the PMT and multiply it times the number of months and the interest rate and all this stuff, and you come up with a monthly payment. And then he told the students, we'll multiply that out. Tell me, you borrowed $100,000. Figure up how much you got to pay back. And so the students started working it, working the formula that he gave them, and multiplying out the monthly payment that they figured up according to the formula, and how many months in the terms of the mortgage. And they figured it up, and they were all looking at each other and looking up at the professor and saying, this can't be right. They looked at each other, and what'd you get? Well, he said, oh, I got this amount. And that's the same thing this guy said. And that can't be right. That's not possible, is it? So they all asked the professor, our answers can't be right. He said, well, how much did you come up with? They said, well, the amount that we borrowed is only $100,000, but according to this formula, we have to pay back over $300,000. He said, it may not sound right, but it is right. You're going to pay back more than three times what you borrow. So what that's talking about, and no, none of us, when we sign a mortgage or a note like that, we don't like to figure up what the total amount paid back is. Generally, what we're concerned about is how much is the monthly payment, whether we can afford that or not. We don't look at the whole thing. But we end up paying back over three times the initial amount. Now, just so you know, when we first built this building and got our mortgage, it was $865,000. What's 300% of that? That's a lot of money, isn't it? And that's all interest. That's just interest. You're paying the bank in order to use their money. So what we're talking about is a long-term relationship with a bank. It's not an intimate relationship, but it's a relationship with a bank. It's not an equal partner relationship. What you do is the bank gives you more money than you deserve, and you pay them back a whole lot more, and you pay, and you pay, and you pay, and you pay. Right? Now, here's the other thing. You got a mortgage on your house, and you feel like you own your home. When you get surveys or applications or something, they will ask you, do you rent a home or do you own a home? And you'll write down, you own the home. If you have a mortgage, you don't really own the home. If your house burns down, who gets the money from the insurance company? Yeah, your bank, right? Mortgage company. Because when you get a mortgage on a house, one of the first things the bank is going to want to know is, do you have insurance on this house? Are we listed as the one who owns the house and finances the house? They're going to get their money first, right? They own the house. Whoever owns the mortgage owns the property. Right? So a lot of folks get this concept warped when it comes to us. God made me. God made you. He owns me. He owns you, right? If you are a Christian, if there has been a time in your life when you've turned from your sin and trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior, then Jesus Christ bought your salvation on a cross like that. He bought you with his blood, right? You are bought with a price, are you not? And the price is his body and blood. He bought you. He paid for you. He owns you. You do not own yourself. Is that right? He owns the mortgage on you, essentially. So you and I are in the position of this servant over here who owed more than we could possibly pay back. And we go to him and say, please forgive me my debt. I'll try to pay you all. I'll pay you everything I owe, but please forgive me. I don't have it right now. I can't pay it right now. And that's the position that you and I are in as believers. We owe him everything. We owe him our life. We owe him our freedom. We owe him our health. We owe him our family. We owe him our house. We owe him our car. Anything you have since you were born. Okay? When you were born, you didn't look like this. You didn't have any clothes. You didn't have any glasses. You didn't have any shoes. You didn't have, like, a Bible. You didn't have the car you got here in. You didn't have the house you stayed in last night. You didn't have anything. Everything came from him. Your salvation came from him. You and I have more than we could pay back in eternity, right? But you know what? God loves you, and he loves me so much that he's canceled that debt. He's canceled the debt. But you and I sometimes get this concept warped, as I started to say a little bit ago. And we begin to think sometimes that God owes us instead of us owing him. You and I may have been in a position at some point in our lives, and you and I probably know somebody who has been in this position in their lives, where they've lost this thing. They've lost that thing. Just fill in the blank. They lost their wife. They lost their husband. They lost their kids. They lost their house. They lost their job. They lost whatever it is they lost. They lost their health. Just fill in the blank. And when they lost this or that or the other thing, they feel like God owes them because they lost this, that, or the other thing. But that's not the right way to look at it. God owns it all. He owns it all. So that brings us to the year of Jubilee. We were reading that just a little bit ago. The year of Jubilee, as I said, is the year when everybody gets all their possessions back. All slaves get all their freedom back. All debts are eliminated. The mortgages are burned for another 50 years. And so God has this relationship with you and I where he owned us when we were his servants, are his servants, right? And we were servants, let me say it this way. We were servants to sin. As Romans chapter 6 says, you were the servants of sin. And he freed us from that. He freed us from that. So we're no longer servants of sin. Now we're servants of his, and this is where I said it wrong just a minute ago. We're servants of his, but willingly so. Willingly so. We are in a relationship with God. Yes, we are his servants, but it's our choice to serve him. Right? You can choose not to serve him, right? And many people do make the choice not to serve him. But you and I serve him, but he wants a relationship with us. On Wednesday nights, we've been talking about Revelation, and we are in the 22nd chapter of Revelation, just started that, where we're talking about the New Jerusalem, where we're going to live with the Lord forever. But when we talk about it that way, it's actually the reverse of what's happening. We're not going to live with him, technically. He's coming to live with us. Because the New Jerusalem is a city that comes down from heaven, and it comes on the earth. It doesn't say it lands on the ground, but it hovers above the mountains. But he's coming down to live with us. We're not going up somewhere above the heavens to live with God in some supernatural kingdom. He's coming down in a very tangible city, a very solid three-dimensional city, and he's going to live with us. He wants a relationship with us, not one of obligation or exploitation or dominion. He wants to be your God. He loves you. He loves me. Amen? It's a personal relationship. That's why Jesus Christ paid our debt on the cross. You know what Jesus said right before he died? He said, "It is finished." In Greek, that's one word. It's a long word. It's tetelestai. And more literally, it means the debt is paid in full. This is what a merchant would have written on a bill if you owed money to, like, the grocery store, and it had piled up and piled up and piled up, and finally you wanted to pay the bill. The grocer would write on that bill at the bottom, tetelestai, paid in full. You and I had a sin debt that we could never, ever, ever pay. But when Jesus died on the cross and gave his body to be broken, his blood to be shed, just before he let out his last breath, he said, "Tetelestai, paid in full." He burned our mortgage on the cross. He did it right there on the spot. Now, you and I, in order to have that applied to us, we have to accept the payment. It's like he wrote a check out, paying your debt. But unless you take that check to the bank and cash it, it's not going to do you any good. I have a check at home that I got from someone, a company, and I like looking at it. I just like looking at the name of the company on the top of the check, and it's sitting on the bookshelf at home. I've had it for about 3 weeks now. Haven't cashed it because I just like looking at the check. It's kind of cool. I did that once years ago. I was selling stuff on eBay, a lot of books and stuff and collectibles and stuff. And I had a book called Serpico. Anybody remember the movie Serpico or the book Serpico? It's about a cop who a New York cop. But anyhow, I sold the book to a guy named Frank Serpico. It was the cop, the guy the book that was written about, the movie that was made, Al Pacino starred in the movie. This guy was the nephew of Serpico, the cop. And so I got this check from Frank Serpico. He wrote it out to me and he signed it. I never cashed it. I kept it because I got a check from Serpico, you know. And so that didn't do me any good financially, right? No good at all because I didn't cash it. Although it's okay, I didn't want the money. The check was more valuable to me than the money was. But in the case of the cross, when Jesus paid your sin debt, you can't afford not to cash that check. You and I have to take that check to the bank of heaven and cash it in order to get our sins paid for, right? But once you do that, then you are free. You're free from your sin debt because you owe a debt you cannot pay. He paid a debt he did not owe. And he did that for you and me, but you have to accept the payment. And the payment is the blood of Christ. Leviticus 17:11 says, "For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls, for it is the blood that maketh an atonement for the soul." And Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22 says, "Without shedding of blood is no remission of sin." So the blood of Jesus Christ is the only thing that can pay for your sin. It's good to join a church, but that won't get you to heaven. It's good to get baptized, but it won't get you to heaven. It's good to give money to church, but that won't get you to heaven. It's good to be good, but that won't get you to heaven. The only thing that does is trusting in what Jesus Christ did on the cross of Calvary, in dying in your place, in being buried in your place, in rising for you. Now, here's where I want to go with this. I don't know about you, but sometimes I feel like I'm still paying the mortgage on my soul. Do memories bother you? Sometimes they do. Had some good memories this morning with Pastor Vic being here, singing some of the songs I've heard in years past and just sitting there just basking in that music. And I just loved it. Your voice hasn't diminished at all. 50 years, that's amazing. They're good memories. But I also have some horrific memories. Regrets. Things that I have done in my life that I wish I hadn't. Things I hadn't done in my life that I wish I had. And you know what? Up here, I know that God has forgiven me. I've repented of my sin. I've repented as a sinner. And I've trusted in Jesus Christ as my Savior, and there's no doubt that I am saved. I am forgiven. I know that up here. But sometimes the accuser can be overheard. I can kind of hear him whispering in my ear, "What makes you think that you can stand behind this pulpit and preach? You're just a sinner. You're no better than anybody else. That's absolutely true. There's a whole lot more people that are probably in this church that know more about the Bible than I do, who could teach and preach the Bible. Satan reminds me of how much of a sinner I am. And so I start feeling like, man, I don't feel like I'm qualified to do this or I should do that, because I feel like I'm still paying the mortgage on my soul. But you know what? I have to be reminded that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And I have to be reminded of that, because Satan will do that to each one of us. He'll remind us of something, and that will be hanging over us, and it'll bring us down. It will discourage us. It can defeat us. It can bring us to despair. It can bring us to depression. It can affect us in all kinds of ways. But we have to be reminded, as David encouraged himself in the Lord his God, we need to encourage ourselves in the Lord our God as well, and in his word and by his spirit, to be reminded that he died for all of our sins. When he died 2,000 years ago, he knew that I was going to be born 1,954 years later, and I would continue to sin up into the 2000s, and every one of the sins that I have committed and will commit, all of them were future when he died on the cross. All of them. So the mortgage has been paid. The mortgage has been paid. All of us, the mortgage has been paid. What I want to encourage you to do, if you have never trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior, I want to give you an opportunity this morning to take care of that. We have counselors in here who'd be glad to show you from the Bible how you can know beyond the shadow of a doubt that your sins are forgiven, you could go to heaven. Don't take my word for it. Don't take anybody's word for it. Don't listen to the preachers on TV or the ones you read in the magazines in the doctor's office. Don't take anybody's word for it, because your soul is more valuable than the entire planet. Don't trust anybody with your soul. The only thing you can trust is the written word of God. And we have counselors who will show you what God says in his word about how you can know that your sins are forgiven, you can go to heaven. If you've never done that, today's the day. Don't let another day go by, because you may not have another. Now, if you are saved, if there's been a time and a place when you've turned from your sin and trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior, then the rest of this is for you. If you are being plagued by past memories of things that you have done or things you haven't done, if things are bothering you that the devil is using to keep you back spiritually, to bring you down, then you need to take care of that today. And here's the way the invitation's going to go today. I've got a sin elimination kit. You didn't know there was a kit for that, did you? I have slips of paper here. They're not very big. And if you have something that's bothering you, I'm going to ask you to come up, take a slip of paper, take a pen, and write that down on that piece of paper. Nobody has to see what you wrote. Just take it, crumple it up, and then up here, right where we burned our mortgage, you can burn that. There it is. Burn that up. And it's gone, just like that. And you don't have to worry about it anymore, because the Lord took care of it. Just release it. Burn your mortgage today. Amen? And that's going to be the invitation. And if you're not comfortable doing what I just did, because those things burn hot and they burn very, very fast, I can do it for you. Crumple it up so I can't see it. Okay? And we'll just burn it right here, where we just burn the mortgage. And you'll take care of your own. Father, thank you so much for being the God that you are, for loving us as we are, and loving us so much you don't want to leave us where we are. You want us to be in a right relationship with you. Father, we know that Jesus paid all our sin debt on the cross. There are some here today who do not know that. who have never appropriated that payment for their own sin, who are still living in bondage. Father, preacher, it helped them to realize they don't have to do that anymore because they no longer need to be accountable to you for their own sin because Jesus was accountable to you for that. He took care of it. No, never mind. Don't worry about it, Harry. Let me finish. Jesus took care of that sin debt, so none of us have to worry about that anymore if we trust in what he finished on the cross for our sin. Thank you, Father, for what Jesus did for us. If there's anybody in here who's not saved, not forgiven, is not a Christian, is not following you, I pray, Lord, that you deal with them. Help them, Lord, to realize that they are a sinner in need of a Savior. Give them the courage to step out today and talk to somebody about their sin and take care of that to this morning. And Father, for those who are saved, I ask, Lord, that you'd help them. If there are any sin bonds that they're still beholden to, anything that's holding them back, Father, preach it, help them to take care of that today. Anything that they're dealing with right now, whether it's, I hate to even mention specifics, there are so many. But Father, I pray, Lord, you'd help us to get rid of those burdens, those bonds of sin, those past guilts and fears and doubts. Help us, Father, to eliminate those today. May your will be done in our lives in this invitation, for we ask it in Jesus' name, for his sake, with thanksgiving. Amen. The invitation's up here. Just come on down around here. Side two. Yeah.
turning man.
A new era where we can move forward and begin reaching our community in greater ways than ever before. We need to think as a pioneer church. That is as if we're starting over. Not one that a church that's been around for 70 years old now and we've done it all and we've done enough. We don't want to think that way at all. We have a whole new generation of people to reach. And we don't have much time in which to do it because I really do believe the Lord is coming back very, very soon. I believe he will come back in your lifetime, in my lifetime, even my lifetime. Yes, I really do think so. He's coming very quickly. So the night is coming when no man can work. So we need to do as much as we can between now and then. I want to thank you again for your faithfulness, all of you, your sacrificial giving, all of you. Your service throughout the week, all of you. Thank you for your solid Christian living throughout the week, all of you. Thank you so much for all that you are and all that you do each and every day for each other and for the folks around you who maybe aren't Christians, who need to become Christians. You're all working and serving the Lord throughout the week. We need to pray for each other, amen? We need to strengthen one another as well. And if you need advice or counseling or questions answered, you need to talk to me about salvation or anything else, we're here all week long. Feel free to call us, call Tammy, make an appointment. We'll be glad to talk with you here or meet with you somewhere else. We need to see as many people as possible in this room and outside of this room saved and serving until the Lord comes back. Amen? Now, let me mention just a couple of things before we close in prayer. We will have our, what are we calling us? An outdoor service. We're having it up in Marengo on County Road 170. There are maps in the lobby. Those of you who remember where John and Doris Baker lived, it's on the same road they lived on, except you turn right instead of left to go to their house. And it's down there. It's not too far away. It's actually a little closer than what John and Doris Baker, where Dave Baker's house was. And we used to have these up there. But this is going to be our Sunday night service. We're going to ask you to bring a side dish or salad or dessert of some kind. Some folks bring chili. Some bring hamburgers. Some bring, you know, what'd you say? Chips? Yeah? pastries, all kinds of things like that. And we'll
bring chocolate chip cookies.
Chocolate chip cookies. You're hearing the requests come in, right? Bring a pack of hot dogs. We'll cook over an outdoor fire. Our service will be around the fire. There is a barn there in case it rains and we have to come in. But we're having it rain or shine. So plan to come up there tonight, 4 o'clock. And there is no charge, but we are asking for a donation. So please be prepared for that. We're not asking for a specific donation. We just want to be a blessing to the folks up there because they're not charging us. But we want to be a blessing to them. Okay? So it's donation only tonight. Plan for that. Also, we are having a membership class first Sunday in November. So if you're interested in Crossroads as a church, plan to come to that. We're glad to answer any questions you have, tell you about our history and all that kind of thing, and you can become a member that day. So that's pretty much all I have. Let's go ahead and close in prayer and ask God to bless us as we leave. Father, thank you so much. Thank you so much for the day, for the blessings of the day, for what it means in the life of this church. Thank you again for all the faithfulness that's been displayed throughout the years by the folks of Columbus Baptist Temple, Crossroads Baptist Church, Northeast Baptist Church to make all this happen. Thank you so much for who you are and all that you have done and are doing and will continue to do through this church to our local community. May you bless us all as we go our various ways. Bring us back again at 4 o'clock this afternoon for our evening service, another very, very special service tonight. We ask it all in Jesus' name, for his sake, with thanksgiving. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you this afternoon in Marengo.